I want to welcome Mark Lilla to Politics and Prose. He is a professor of humanities who specializes in intellectual history with a particular focus on political and religious thought. You can read on the back of his book that Fareed Zakaria writes, he is one of America's foremost intellectuals. Before Columbia, he taught at the University of Chicago, that home of Leo Strauss. And at the University of Chicago, he was in the Committee on Social Thought, which is the interdisciplinary PhD program, which is certainly an intellectual exercise, if ever there was one in this country, and also at New York University. During all these times, he's been a regular essayist for the New York Review of Books and other publications. He's also written several books, including The Reckless Mind, which has just been republished. So he's here on the occasion of publication of two books, the republication of The Reckless Mind, a new edition, and his new book, The Shipwrecked Mind. He's going to be in conversation with Andrew Sullivan, who's a former editor of The New Republic and the author or editor of six books, all of which Andrew has been to Politics and Prose to talk about. So Andrew is an old friend of the store. Andrew was also a pioneer of political blogging. And although he officially retired from blogging, his blog reappeared this year during the Democratic Convention. Last night, I was actually reading an afterword in The Reckless Mind, and I came across a short section that just kind of struck me so much that I wanted to quote it. Never since the end of World War II has political thinking in the West seemed so shallow, so clueless. We all sense that ominous changes are taking place in Western societies, yet we lack adequate concepts and even vocabulary for describing the world as we find ourselves, the world we now find ourselves in. More worrisome still, we lack awareness that we lack them. A cloud of willful unknowingness seems to have settled on our intellectual life. This is the first thing we need to understand about the present. So on that, I'm going to let Andrew start in conversation with Mark Lilla. And after 25 minutes, half an hour, we'll have questions. We have a mic here. We need customers to go to the mic. So thank you for coming, and welcome Mark and Andrew.
Thank you, Barbara.
Thank you very much. We're going to have a conversation, I hope, not an interview, a conversation, about the book and about how it relates to our current moment, and then I hope we'll be able to enlarge that conversation with some of you. I just want to say, first off, I think this is an extraordinary book. The monographs in it, and that's what they are, a succession of monographs, are among the most lucid and insightful that I've read on any of these authors. It's very hard, trust me, to write about political theorists in a way that does not get completely clogged or completely confusing, which takes extraordinarily complex thinkers and arguments and manages to get to their essence. And so I can't really recommend this book enough. And I also think that this is a moment to read it. I want to start by asking Mark a broad question, really, which is, and this is something that some liberals or progressives have trouble with, what do you think, if you were to distinguish between the reactionary mind and the conservative mind, right, would be the distinguishing characteristic of the reactionary mind?
Right. First, let me just thank you all for coming out and welcome you to Antiques Roadshow. it's the right question, and it's the right question to begin with. Conservatism, classically conceived, is is based on an insight about human nature. There's a distinction between liberalism and conservatism, a quarrel, really, about what we are as creatures. Classically, the liberal presumes or begins political thinking on the assumption that we're individuals, that we're bearers of rights, that we construct our own lives, and that all of our political obligations derive from our rights and contracts. So there's a priority of the individual to society. The conservative, classically, presumes the opposite, that we come into a world that's already formed, and in coming into that world, we have obligations, and those obligations extend not only to others in the present, but to those who will come in the future. And that whatever rights we are endowed with come, emerge out of an understanding and traditional basis of a society and mores and all the rest. So that's a quarrel over what kind of creatures we are. Revolutionaries and reactionaries, their quarrel is about history and not about human nature. Both revolutionaries and reactionaries believe that history, that you can have a break, a radical break in history. The revolutionary believes that that break is going to come, and after it, some radically improved or utopian future is before us. The reactionary assumes that that break has already happened, and it's been a catastrophe. And all of his thinking derives from this assumption about history. So conservative reaction isn't an extreme form of conservatism at all. They're simply about different things. They bring a different political, a different psychology to politics. The older I get, the less interested I am in political philosophy and theory, the more interested I've become in political psychology. And the psychology not only of publics and nations, but also the psychology of people who think philosophically about politics. So I've tried to disentangle these different psychologies when it comes to our present situation. That was a very long answer, sorry.
No, it's a fascinating answer. with respect to history, I mean, is the reactionary a function mainly of modernity? Did reactionaries exist before the French Revolution? Is there a reactionary temperament before there is this understanding of history?
Oh, sure. My favorite example is Cato the Elder, Roman patrician who lived in very important Roman politician in sort of high to getting into the late Republican period. As Rome became more powerful and also more complex and corrupt, he was sure that Greek philosophy was undermining the Republican virtues of Rome, the simplicity, the military virtues, and traditional religion. And so he went on an attack on Greek philosophy. And when he finally came into some power, a group of visiting philosophers from Greece, which had already been conquered by the Romans, came to Rome and were teaching young people. And the moment he got the power to do so, he packed them on a ship and sent them home. Now, his view was that a break was occurring in history because of this, that a Republican past was being lost. And secondly, and very importantly, it was possible to pinpoint who the agents of change were. And so there's always a scapegoat in a reactionary story, some kind of elite who has betrayed his country. And that can be intellectuals, it can be Jews, it can be journalists, it can be university professors. But Cato set the model in a way of not anti-intellectualism, but counter-intellectualism. that the intellectuals are the problem and they're going to bring our culture down.
So would the Counter-Reformation be a classic reactionary movement in that sense?
No, I think the Counter-Reformation was actually a conservative movement in the sense that there was this challenge of the Reformation, and which is why it's actually, historians no longer call it the Counter-Reformation, but they call it the Catholic Reformation. Because the message to Catholic Rome was, we somehow have to simplify the faith. We have to get rid of as much magical thinking as we can. And we have to bring that faith down to individuals. And so that's when you see confraternities of lay people that start praying together, just like prayer meetings today. It's when you see Ignatius Loyola, St. Ignatius, develop a kind of psychotherapy for the believer. So that was a conservative movement, right? Reaction really comes back, as you suggested, after the French Revolution, and in reaction to an idea of something called modernity.
Right. Tell me, I want to focus a little bit, because the book is beautifully focused on a few thinkers. And one of the most controversial and one of the most interesting and is Leo Strauss. And you and I have both been interested in his thought for a very long time. And I think it's often caricatured. And what's very interesting about this book is how I think the discussion of Strauss really does rob him of that caricature and makes you see a thinker that's actually complex and interesting. Tell me, what do you think is the greatest misconception about Leo Strauss's thought?
Most recently in the popular imagination that somehow Strauss imagined that there was a distinction between those who knew what was going on in politics and had the levers of power, an unwashed people who had to be kept happy with bread and circuses and religion, and that this elite was behind the Iraq War. That you heard a lot of that. In fact, after the war started, I was still teaching at the University of Chicago, and I walked onto campus one day, and the Lyndon LaRouche people were out, passing out, and I still have it somewhere, these little flyers about Strauss and the Iraq War and the conspiracy. And there were, just as in, sometimes you run into neighborhoods, you run into Hasids who come up and say, are you Jewish? They were there going around, are you a Straussian? What I try to do in the essay is I try to disentangle Strauss's thinkings. And there is a reactionary element in this, or there's an idea that reactionaries use, that there was a break that we can specify in history, in intellectual history, before which there were certain assumptions, after which there were other assumptions, and that's when things started to go bad. And Strauss was never, it took him a while to figure out where he thought this break took place. At first he thought it was Hobbes, then it was Machiavelli. When Strauss came to America, and he came here really by chance, he happened to be out of Germany when Hitler rose to power and was in England and came to the United States, he developed an American following that brought very American assumptions and also American Jewish assumptions to him. Speaking to older Straussians, one thing they will tell you sometimes is that going into his classes, it was the first time I felt I could be proud to be a Jew. This is the 1950s, when everyone it was assumed that you would change your name. If you were able to get a university job, you had to be careful not to stress your Jewishness. And he was a man who proudly talked about it, gave courses on Maimonides, talked about the tension between reason and revelation, and they fell in love with him, and one can see why. But when the 60s came, for some reason, the way they read Strauss prepared them for an apocalyptic moment. And when things went nuts in the 60s, especially at Cornell University, where things were very bad and very violent, people with guns, there were a lot of Straussians there, and they thought they were seeing a repeat of history. As Alan Bloom put it in one sentence of his book, The Closing of the American Mind, there's no difference between Nuremberg and Woodstock. So they brought this view that there's a break in history and that modernity was going to run into the ground, and they thought it was being fulfilled in their lifetime. Most of them had been sort of moderate Democrats. They became more radicalized, eventually became Republicans, became part of the establishment here, and the rest of the history living here you know quite well. So it's a fascinating story of misunderstanding, I think, on the one hand, but also a way in which these American students saw that something in Strauss's thought could go in this direction, that there was a kind of apocalypticism implicit in his thinking because of his focus on this radical break, after which things started going badly.
Thank you. I was going to ask you what then was Strauss's great insight, the greatest insight for you? What is in Strauss's thought? What does one properly understand as the most valuable contribution that he's made to our understanding of the whole?
Yeah, I would say.
I know this is a rather crude question.
It's not at all. It's. I think it's crucial also for our moment, actually. Not only was he an extraordinary reader and a serious philosopher, but he had an insight sort of derived from medieval Arab thinkers and also Maimonides, that there's a tension between the philosophical life and political life. That philosophy is not about coming up with theories of X, Y, and Z. That a true philosopher lives as a skeptic and has to be, and is tentative about everything. And it's a very difficult way to live without certainty about anything, but to still have the courage to push forward and inquire. It's not an easy way to live, and not many people can do it. In politics, you need certainty about certain things, or you need a shared sense of certainty. We take these truths to be self-evident. We begin there. Yeah, that's an assumption. And any society requires that. It can be a religious foundation. It can be around a political idea. It can be around certain mores of an ethnic group. All sorts of things can be taken as unquestioned. But the philosophical life, properly understood, is always going to run into problems with that, both for the philosopher, because he's going to question these sorts of things, and also for the society, because you can't have people, if there's a lot of questioning of the foundations of the society, there might be problems. Now that's a very, now for me, the insight that I take away has to do with the nature of philosophy, and both the requirement of courage to live in uncertainty, and also to live in a kind of wonder about just the fact that anything is. It's also a wonderful way to live. But I think that what many of his students have thought more about is the threat of thinking to society. And so that fits in, that thought can be turned into an analysis of history to say, aha, it's those who think who are corrupting our society, which fits into a reactionary sort of mindset. And so, for instance, in the 1970s and early 80s, neoconservatives who were influenced by Leo Strauss started talking about a new adversarial class. And it was intellectuals, it was lawyers, it was journalists, who had values that were quite different from the values of middle America. And not only were they able to had their hands on power in Washington, but also through the universities and the press, they were changing traditional American values, right? So you can see how one of these ideas can, in a very different context, have really unforeseen consequences.
To broaden it out a little bit more to our present moment, which is obviously an extraordinary one, are we in a seriously reactionary moment in the West right now? I mean, it seems that that the impact of globalization in particular, and of the global economy, and of a multicultural society, a genuinely multicultural one in ways that we've never experienced before, are prompting quite clearly what one might call simply a reaction and resistance. To what extent is this a particularly dangerous moment? To what extent is this, can this reactionary moment be perhaps contained within a conservative sensibility? To what extent is, at this point, the forces behind it so great that it's, I mean, you talk in the book of how reactionary movements and ideas are just as powerful in many ways as revolutionary ideas, but we've not spent enough time, and we don't spend enough time thinking about what those ideas are. Is that where we are right now? And how do you see the extraordinary shifts that are occurring throughout Europe, and indeed now with the Trump candidacy?
Yeah. Well, I think in order to think about this question, one has to distinguish sort of a reactionary mindset or passion in the public, reactionary ideas, and reactionary leaders. And if you look at different countries, you'll see different mixes of that. Do they have leaders? Do they have ideas? Is this sentiment widely shared or just shared among an elite? And you'll see reactionary, we are seeing reactionary phenomena, not only in the West, but political Islamism is obviously one. In Turkey, President Erdogan's appeal back to a glorious Ottoman past, in a very crude sense, the horrible new president of the Philippines, who wants to murder thousands of drug addicts and has stirred up these kind of populist passions. But in these different countries, there are people who are thinking in this way and articulating themselves, and there are people who are leaders who've learned how to master this. The American situation for me is harder to understand because what all these countries share, I think, is a sense of displacement that Andrew was referring to. You know, most of the world, while we were worrying about the Cold War and other things and modernization, since the 19th century, most of the world has been feeling displaced by the intrusion of the West and modernity. So elsewhere in the world, people have been dealing with a sense that all that's solid melts into air and there are challenges to tradition, which leads to reactions. This is finally coming home to the West because the West is being westernized for the first time, or feels itself being westernized. And with changes in, the economy, internet culture, movements of people, and we can't underestimate the effect of the internet on all of this and the different things it makes possible. For example, just the fact that you can share videos and photos online, especially video, live video, means that people all over the world who might think of coming to the West can see a friend of theirs who's already there walk around his apartment with a camera or go down the streets, and they can see what's there. And of course, they see a very selective image of what's there, but these images are drawing people, yeah? But people in our own countries are feeling this sense of displacement. For me, the reactionary politics, I think the story at the political level begins not with Donald Trump, but with Sarah Palin. That in an important sense, Donald Trump is just a footnote to Sarah Palin. Because when she became a candidate. Ignorance became respectable, and not just a joke, but actually respectable, a sense that she somehow had some wisdom. And the wise guys who brought her to McCain and convinced her to him to put her on the ticket were convinced that they could be the Savonarolas and kind of manipulate this woman and be her kitchen cabinet. And there was a distinction between the few and the many, yeah? And it was a kind of anti-intellectualism, not just counter-intellectualism, that is intellectuals who are against intellectuals, other intellectuals, but anti-intellectualism. And this urge has not yet become articulate as thought in the way that if you look at other countries with other sorts of traditions like Hungary and in France, you know, there are long traditions of reaction to modernity, and which can involve nationalism and religion and all the rest, to draw on, to develop ideas about this, that then, in fact, not just ordinary people, but intellectuals. That has not happened here yet. And also, Trump is not a leader of this. He is being swept by a wave. And he does not even know how to manipulate it and direct it. Except by, he has a kind of intuitive sense of what to say, but he's not someone who's going to be able to build a movement to take over a government in the way that the Kaczynski brothers in Poland or Orban in Hungary or any number of examples that you can list. So right now, the American reaction is pure id. And it is yet to find either an ego or a superego. And if it does not, I think there's a greater chance that the fever will pass and the patient will be sleeping soundly. But if it becomes articulate and starts to convince members of the intellectual class, and if there is a real charismatic leader, then we've entered a new period in American history, I think.
That's all very interesting and sobering. I'm going to broaden this now to invite you into this conversation. Just put your hand up. There's a mic here and a mic here. So if you want to ask a question, come up to one of those mics and have at it. Yes, ma'am.
Hi. I'm Peggy Sands Wachowski. I'm a congressional reporter for a Hispanic magazine with. I cover a lot about immigration, so I'm really, really interested in this topic. One quick question: when you said America is now becoming westernized or something that we're not, do you mean globalization? It sounds like the Western part is a global thing where there's no borders or boundaries anymore, and there is a reaction to that. But what I'm wondering and seeing in a lot in the politics these days. I mean, everyone talks about how the Republicans use fear. They're driven by fear. But I think, and I'm so curious if you've thought about what this is, I think liberals are very much, the liberal movement has been driven by guilt. That in guilt over the Holocaust, guilt over slavery, guilt over everything, refugees and poverty in the world and all that. And it seems to me the reactionaries are tired of feeling guilty. They have their own things that they're concerned about, and they're just not going to feel guilty. And I don't see any feelings. I mean, Bush, there was a bit of compassionate conservative with him, but there's none of that with Trump or the people supporting him. They just don't want to feel guilty anymore. So I'm wondering if you've looked at the power of guilt.
Wow, I hadn't thought about that. Well, guilt develops psychologically when the id runs into the superego, right? Pure id is just your impulse for whatever you want. And then what happens is you run into social conventions and things your parents told you, and you somehow have to restrain yourself, and then you internalize those rules yourself. The picture you give of of liberals or Democrats is certainly the picture that these reactionaries have of liberals and Democrats. It's not the picture I have of them. But the fact that people feel this way means that it's an important thing to consider. And but you know, I would say that there are two ways of wanting to escape guilt. One is when you just feel it's unfair. The other is when you're incapable of feeling guilt about anything anymore, because you're shameless. And I think there's a kind of shamelessness that points to the decline of religious morality in this country. Because the idea is that you shouldn't be ashamed of anything. Donald Trump should not be ashamed of anything he says. You shouldn't have to apologize for anything. The lack of humility. And so I guess I would turn it around to say that I think that it's a kind of projection onto the Democratic Party of a parent, so to speak, telling you you've done something wrong, and you don't want to feel you did anything wrong, that it's more adolescent. Sure.
This is a conversation. Can I just
quickly, yeah.
Journalism follow-up question here. Doesn't capitalism enforce that?
Yes.
That you can feel guilty about anything except making a profit. When it comes to making a profit, and here I include immigrants as cheap labor.
Sure. No, it's exactly right. And that's what I meant by the West being westernized. Is that, you know, hyper-capitalism is here without the morality that you know, softened it before. Hyper-individualism, libertarianism. Yeah.
Sean.
Hey, Mark, I really enjoyed that. I interviewed you recently over the phone.
Oh, yeah. Hi.
We haven't quite met yet.
How are you?
In the book, you, in distinguishing the reactionary from the revolutionary, you talk about the revolutionary as someone who is sort of fixated on some future project, some utopian project that they need to build, whereas the reactionary is someone who is nostalgic about some phantasm they call the past, right? Some lost golden age. But what they share is a kind of indifference to the present, right? For whatever reason, the present isn't what it ought to be, and we need to change that. I wonder if you think these two orientations are equally diluted. And perhaps more importantly, do you think they're equally dangerous?
Well, the answer to both those questions is yes. The psychology of this is a little complicated. Once you're convinced that it's possible to get to a utopian state, or that that state existed in the past, then the present starts looking worse. The more you believe that that existed or will exist, the more the present looks worse. The worse the present looks, the more you're likely to appeal to either the past or some imaginary future. So there's a perfect symmetry there, I think. And one sees it in, if you talk to people who are thinking of voting for Donald Trump or are, and I mean educated people, there's a sense that we just need to blow things up and start over, as if this is a movie. And so the lack of responsibility for the present is very striking. But there is one asymmetry. And the asymmetry is that a utopian lives on, a revolutionary operates on the basis of hope for the future. And hope can always be disappointed, because things happen that seem to refute the hopes. Nostalgia is irrefutable because it's lost in the past. And so the nostalgic has a slight advantage over the revolutionary because his way out of the present appeals to something people think at least happened.
Thanks, Mark.
Thanks.
Yes, sir.
Hi, Basit Chaudhry. Thanks so much for your writing. My question, I think, probably builds on something you just said, I think. But under what set of circumstances can you envision or see this reactionary moment kind of exhausting itself? And I ask because for, you know, probably a couple of centuries, we've had recurrent failure after failure with the revolutionary mindset. And I think perhaps that has become exhausted, and we've learned empirically from that, whether it's, you know, from the ex-Soviet Union to Cambodia, you feel this exhaustion in people there. But I guess my concern is sort of, it's hard, more difficult to envision how the reactionary mindset similarly exhausts itself. Maybe that's just a cynical way of looking at it, but it feels to me it's different, and different in a more concerning way, because it's less empirically verifiable.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, it's as soon as reactionaries have a program for the present, then they raise hopes, which can be disappointed, and you can run out of gas that way. But, of course, the reactionary can always keep saying, well, we actually haven't fully returned to the past, just as the revolutionary can say, no, the revolutionary program has not been fully put into place. And if you can successfully do that, you can run on fumes for a long time, which I feel is what, you know, congressional Republicans have been doing for a long time. They have no program, but they keep going by complaining about the other side and raising people's fears and talking about things being better. And so they're avoiding having to put forward a program, because then, they could face failure. And so if you can keep displacing people's attention to this past or to a possible future, you can stay in business a long time. But as soon as you actually have to run a government, that's when the problems begin.
I just want to touch base on one thing you said earlier, and to ask a sort of provocative question, which is, do not reactionaries have a point right now? That by your very words, you said, you know, one of the things we're grappling with is a sort of shameless society, which is related to hypercapitalism and the collapse of religious morality. Is it not legitimate to worry that both hypercapitalism, both the internet, and the collapse of basic social and religious morality in people's lives is leading to a situation in which people's lives are less meaningful, less in control, and much more terrifying than they used to be, and that in some ways what we're feeling is a fever, but the fever is about a real problem. There is actually an infection at some level. And what role does religion have in taming, or religious morality have in taming some of the things that we're seeing right now? And to what extent is what I've just said a reactionary rather than a completely rational perspective?
Oh, yeah. Well, it's important to specify this, that decline happens. And when things decline and get worse, there's nothing reactionary about noting that and trying to set things aright. And so you can imagine a kind of conservative reformism or a liberal progressive reformism that takes the present, accepts what is a fait accompli, tries to work around it, and tries to turn things back, right? And so there are all kinds of theories of decline going back to, well, back to the Hebrew Bible, back to Arabic thought about how empires decline and then rise again and can restore themselves. But the reactionary is convinced, and I'll say this again, of two things. One is that there's been a radical break in history, that we've been separated, that there's a discontinuity in time, and that we can specify the agents of that change. And as soon as you think that there's a chasm between you and the way the world should be, and no bridges are left or can be built, and you know who's to blame, then you're prepared for a messiah. And you're in a very different sort of mental space, right? And your indifference to meliorism makes all sorts of sense. Why try to participate in the present and make little changes when, in fact, the whole system, everything's been corrupt. We've all been corrupted, and we're separated from where we should be. So, you know, reaction goes along with a kind of messianism that I think both of those are alien to conservative and liberal meliorist traditions that recognize when things have gone off track and but are willing to think hard about how to dig our way out of this in the present.
Thank you. I don't want to... yes.
I guess my question is just why now? I mean, I understand what you're saying about the ideology, and for people who are committed to that ideology, you know, it's understandable, but for the average person, so yeah, we had this terrible recession in 2008, but we sort of were clawing our way out of it. Why is reaction such a threat now when things are really, we're not in a dire economic crisis?
No, it's exactly the right question because, you know, you keep reading articles about people in coal country and meth epidemics and all the rest, and you can understand, but that's not the whole country. You know, there are guys in dockers sitting in cubicles in office parks, you know, with their double soy lattes who are voting for Trump, you know, and their wives work and, you know, they're living middle class lives. What is that about? Yeah. I think there's another element. And well, I think to think about this phenomenon, you've got to decide the degree to which you want to take seriously what people are saying. And I hear a lot of echo of what the media has put forward, people saying, well, this is why I'm voting for Trump. Yeah? I'm more struck by the anti-politics of the moment, the disinvestment in political life, the disinvestment in being informed about political life. So political life is not seen as something that I participate in, but that happens over there. It's their thing. The Italians say, cosa loro. It's their thing. And so it leads to tremendous irresponsibility, a kind of childishness about politics that is encouraged by Fox News and other and shock radio. And people like that become susceptible to these sorts of stories, yeah? So it's, I don't know how to put it. It's a lack of citizenship, a decline of civic responsibility that you wouldn't be informed, that it wouldn't matter to you if someone doesn't know what he's talking about. So when I think about that, I become very worried because that kind of change, it's very hard to rebuild that. You know, these passions can float by, but how do you rebuild a sense of civic responsibility and civic duty? I don't know.
Yes, ma'am.
Well, my question was so similar to the last one. I actually was going to say that I think that had the recession not happened, Trump would not have the... I think that's what animates it. Yes, there are people who are drinking lattes that are voting for him. But it seems to me that had that not happened, we wouldn't have a strong reaction as what we've had, you know, in support of Trump.
I would just say I think that the story about elites, which you've portrayed as a critical part, the identification of what is now called the global elite, or global elitists is now a term you see out there in the alt-right mm-hmm. world, mm-hmm. Is a function of two things. One, that of the Iraq War, in which many of the people voting, you know, more likely to vote for Trump actually fought and were involved with, and was, by all accounts, an obvious catastrophe, which was an invention of the elites. The elites were found derelict. And equally, obviously, in terms of international finance, the implosion of 2008. Now, the second thing is that the elites never took responsibility for either of those two things. There was absolutely no accountability. And therefore, the story about the elites that are, in Mr. Trump's words, stupid, has gained particular traction through those historical events. And I also think simultaneously, it's impossible to look at the extraordinary demographic shifts of the last 30 years and not expect a case of indigestion, cultural indigestion, in as much as the pace of change socially has seemed to accelerate in ways that people don't know how to control, and that their own communities feel not what they were. And that, I think, my own view is that that has rendered this particular paradigm. There was a time when America was great. All this is now in danger, and messianism is obviously part of what's fascinating to me about the Trump phenomenon is actually its content-free nature. That this is a classic messiah figure, a cult leader, who I alone will fix it. Don't you worry about what I'll do. Don't you worry about what I'm going to replace Obamacare with. It's going to be fabulous. Don't you worry about getting rid of ISIS. I know how to do it. Just leave it to me. Again, the political disengagement and lack of citizenship is critical. Of course, my association of that is with Plato's argument about the emergence of tyranny out of end-stage democracy, which is the one I just want to contribute that.
What he said.
Sir.
The assertion has been made at least twice in the last 30 minutes or so that we are living in a time of declining religious morality. I wish to disagree with that totally. Now, we're living in a time of deranged religious morality, but it's not that different from the religious morality of less threatening times. My point is that there are people who firmly believe that it is all right to be wrong in defense of a larger right. Now, you may call that hypocrisy, but they don't see it as hypocrisy. They are fighting a battle that we may not be aware of. But it is highly moral to them. What is the evidence that we are living in a time of declining morality? Church attendance, yes, I will agree with you on that, but not morality. Most of the people who do not go to church today are profoundly religious. Their religion is something that you might disagree with. It is ill-defined, it is nebulous, but it's religion. And their behavior is moral. I was glad to hear you say that you have shifted your interest a little more towards political psychology. I'm so glad to hear that because so many political theorists think and write as though psychology doesn't exist, anthropology is in its infancy. Much of what they have to say, the political fictions that they talk about, have nothing to do with the lessons that we are learning now from science and about how societies are organized, how people come to believe in gods, how these things are used to stabilize societies and so on. So
let me answer the first part of your question because you've called me on it and you were right to. Ross Douthat has made, the columnist at the New York Times has made this case before, and he had a book about it, the title of which escapes me, where his argument is that when you have a decline of traditional religiosity in the United States, you don't get atheism, you get worse religion.
Yes, I agree.
Right?
I agree.
And you know, there are different sides to Christianity. There's the side of modesty, charity, and humility.
Pacifism.
And on the other hand, there are messianic prophets who believe that, you know, they have a message from God and speak in tongues and all the rest, right? And so, you know, all of that may exist in a kind of religious space. So thank you for that.
All right.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Yeah, when I was young, conservative movement seemed quite vibrant. Russell Kirk and the Buckleys at one level, and Eric Voegelin and Leo Strauss and so forth at a deeper level. And that's all gone. And how is it that conservatism has run itself into the ground?
Power corrupts absolutely, intellectually speaking. I think it was coming to power. And the thirst for power among, I mean, the age you were talking about, conservatives felt themselves on the outside in Washington, in the universities, but they still are in universities. But I think the coming to Washington changed a lot. I used to be, I was an editor of the Public Interest back in the early 1980s, a neoconservative magazine that had a lot of influence just through its writing and kind of changed the debate about welfare policy in this country, for example. I was there when, and then Ronald Reagan was elected. And I was working for Irving Kristol at the time, and suddenly the phone was ringing all day long with Ed Meese on the phone asking for people to put into various slots. And these were all professors who had been Straussians and all the rest. And they started playing Washington politics, which is fine. It's a transition if you do it. But what it means is that you're no longer refreshing yourself intellectually. And so it's hard to find, the number of serious conservative intellectuals has just declined precipitously because they've all become part of the machine, which is a media machine, a foundation machine. And I'm defending conservatives on campus often, and often I'll get the response, well, who should we appoint? Who's out there? And I used to have answer to that question. I don't anymore. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ma'am.
So as far as in the United States, the question of this reactionary feeling that's going on, it seems to me that there's a strain that's happened here since the founding of the country, that there were elements that could be brought together as reactionary. The American dream, American exceptionalism, all of these things having been betrayed, that I connected in some way with a concept of Nietzsche's of raison d'etre, which there's no way to go except to blame somebody. And there have been other periods in this country where it's emerged, that kind of feeling, and then been abated for some reason or other. And is there a possibility in terms of this being another blip and then going down?
I do think so, because any political movement is going to raise hopes, and hopes can be disappointed. But Americans feed off of hope, which means that we are the least stoical people on earth. And so we believe we can get new lives. We can believe tomorrow is another
new
day,
heaven.
And we're going to go to the barn and put on a show, and the world's going to be different. And the more exaggerated our hopes, the deeper our despair, and we get into a negative cycle of the more despairing we are, the more our hopes get raised of a radical change, which then leads to despair. And that just seems, I've written something that's online today for a New York magazine about this, about our addiction to hope. And I think that's part of the problem, and which is why it may go away, but it will go away sort of by itself. But it's hard to address that because it means questioning, our addiction to hope. I wish people would listen not to Nietzsche, but Kafka. Kafka was once asked by his best friend after Kafka had done a little book reading of one of his stories, and he came up to him and he said, "Franz, that was such a downer. Do you really believe there's no hope on earth?" And he said, "Hope? Of course there's hope. Infinite hope. Just not for us."
Well, on that note, I think we will cheerfully wrap this up. I wanted to thank Mark very much for this wonderful conversation, and the great thing about Mark's book is it's an intellectual book. Mark is not interested in power. He's interested in freedom. And yet, at the same time, it casts an indirect light upon very urgent and contemporary matters. So I urge you to buy it and read it. And
if you like it, buy also The Reckless Mind.
Yes.
And it's expanded edition, both of which I'm happy to sign.
And I want to thank both of you, Andrew, Mark, for a very stimulating afternoon. Thank you very, very much.